Thank you so much for coming. I can't tell you how happy we are to see this level of interest in this project. I know it's really hard to find time on a Wednesday night in the middle of a school year to come to a public meeting. So thank you so much. We're really excited to see this level of interest. Before we get started, does everyone have a little voting clicker thing? If you don't, raise your hand and some folks will bring you one. Okay, great. Again, welcome. My name is Catherine Caffrey. I'm the Director of Community Affairs with the City of Cedar Park. We're so excited to see you all here. And before we get started, I want to kind of recognize a couple of folks that have been happy to join us tonight. First, our Mayor Matt Powell's here. List, so you might want to save that clapping at the end.
No, it's okay.
Council members John Lux, Lyle Grimes, and Corbin Van Arsdale are here, and one more. Did I miss any other council member? Our former mayor, Bob Lemon, is here, and a former council member, Mitch Fuller, if they want to wave. Compliment to see the former mayor of Leander here. I saw Mayor Kalman sneak in. All right, now that's a compliment when the other city's coming. We also have some board and commission members here for the city I'd like to recognize. We have Matthew Olguin from the Tourism Board, Kevin Lancaster from the 4A Economic Development Board, Kelly Brent from P&Z, Planning and Zoning, Brian Rice from our 4B board is here. We also have Lindy Matthews, the Vice President of the Chamber of Commerce here, so we appreciate the Chamber's partnership on this as well. I saw our City Manager just walking in the back, Brenda Evans. So welcome. Our Assistant City Managers, Josh Selick and Sam Roberts, I think I also saw them sneak in, as well as our City Attorney, J.P. LeComp, as well as lots of other city staff. So we are here and excited to see you. Before I turn over the presentation to Rebecca Leonard from Design Workshop, I wanted to spend a moment talking a little bit about where this project got started. Some of y'all may remember or maybe participated in the Imagine Cedar Park project. It was an online forum we launched that a lot of people participated in as part of the city's overall comprehensive plan. In city terms, a comprehensive plan is our long-term vision for how we want the community to look and feel. It's a citizen-led and really citizen-input heavy project. The City Council passed that in late 2014, and one of the priorities that was identified as part of that comprehensive plan is to revitalize Bell Boulevard. By show of hands, who's lived in Cedar Park longer than, let's say, 10 or 15 years? Okay. So you all know Bell Boulevard near and dear. You know it well. And Bell Boulevard is really not only our primary north-south corridor, but it's really also the backbone of Cedar Park. And it's an area that's been identified as needing a little bit of revitalization. So where we are in this project now, and what's going to happen tonight, is we're really going through the input process. I know this chart may be a little bit hard to read for those of you in the back. We have a printed out one in the back. You're welcome to look at a little bit later. The purpose of tonight's meeting is you'll hear a presentation about some of the initial ideas and concepts for what we're thinking about with Bell Boulevard. And what we want to hear from you all through a variety of voting and interactive measures is what you'd like to see. We are really in the input and data collection phase. We want to hear from you all about what you'd like to see on Bell Boulevard. That helps us kind of form some concepts that we'll come back to the public and city leadership with, get some more feedback, and then we'll keep going down the process and maybe finalize a concept that will then be part of a plan that will be considered for future projects. I have been so happy to be getting quite a few emails from people already interested in the project. I've tried to respond to everyone, so keep them coming. But really, we're not in a place where we have anything done yet. What we want to hear from you all is help us form this plan. So there's no dirt turning anytime soon. We're really in that planning phase. So with that, I'm happy to hand it over to Rebecca Leonard with Design Workshop.
Great. Thank you. Thank you, Catherine. And
and your phones. Just, I'm suspecting you might need those. Can everybody hear me in the back of the room? Okay. Hardly? Did I hear? Everybody can hear? Great. Good. As Catherine said, I'm Rebecca Leonard. I'm with a design workshop for urban designers, planners, landscape architects, and we do projects like this all over the country. We've got 10 offices, and I'm just right down the road in Austin. I've got with me a few folks, Rachel Tepper, who probably signed you in, Summer McNamara, who is right here, and Ryan Wright, who's been helping us as well. He's in the back of the room, and we're available for questions anytime, you know, before or after the meeting. And we also have a couple other firms that are helping us. We know that the needs, the knowledge that has to happen to make this a successful project are vast. And so we've involved Bingley and Barfield for traffic engineering and corridor studies. And Brian Rice, who's a local Cedar Park person, is representing that firm on our team. We also have RC Elco, which is a national market and finance firm. We've got a couple folks here that are helping us, Trish Kennelly and John Cavill. And they are helping keep us honest. You know, designers love to draw pretty pictures, but we want to make sure that it's based in market reality and that it's actually a doable project at the end of the day. We also have a firm, Page, also in Austin. Ryan Loesch was here, there he is. And they're an architecture firm, and they're helping us with some, envisioning some of the three-dimensional pieces of this project. As Catherine said, you've got keypad pulling devices. And with a big crowd like this, the purpose of these is to allow everybody to have a voice, because obviously we're not going to be able to hear from everybody. So we want to make sure that even the brightest person in the room can say what they feel about these questions. We will pause at times and take a few questions, but just to get through the materials, we're going to keep pressing on, but we'll be here answering questions after the meeting as long as we need to. Okay, so we're going to practice with the keypad polling devices just a second. The questions will look something like this. They're probably a lot more serious and dire. I don't know how big of a fan you are, but... who do you think is going to win the Super Bowl? And you see that there's a couple numbered answers there. 1, 2, and 3. And on the keypad polling device, each button is numbered. And so if you agree with number 1, which I personally do, then you hit 1. If you agree with 2, hit 2. If you think that you know, want to vote on this, then just don't hit anything. It'll only tally the votes that people have. Now let's say you type one in and you change your mind. And you think, wait a minute, no, the Patriots are going to win. After all, they always win and they cheat. So, why is that vote number 2? You can always change. It only remembers the last number that you typed in. Okay? So don't panic if you change your mind. All right. So anybody need more time on this question? You got this one? Okay. I'm going to close this poll. Afterwards, you'll see that the Seahawks are indeed going to win. And so you'll see that the answers immediately. And I really didn't bring that up. So, okay, let's move on with the content. So we have just begun this project, as Catherine said. And we've done some initial stakeholder outreach just to make sure that we knew sort of what sort of things we need to be thinking about. And it could inform some of our initial data collection and other things. So we have met personally with property owners and business owners in those parcels there that you see colored yellow. We also have sent letters to every property owner and every business owner in the area that's colored orange. And the reason is because we wanted to make sure we had good representation of a variety of people here. Those letters had information about how to get plugged in to the e-newsletter, about this meeting. It also had a link to some surveys for property owners and business owners specifically. So we've already been engaging people in this process. These are just some of the things we heard. Just again, they're litmus tests of what we should be open to and expecting through this process. What's the biggest physical challenge or biggest physical issue? We heard a lot about the challenges getting in and out of businesses and properties off of Bell Boulevard. There's curves, there's grade changes, you scrape a bumper, it's hard to see where the exit exits and entrances are. There's no opportunity for pedestrians to get from one business to the other. You have to climb over, you know, landscaping and other things. People thought it looked a little dated and wasn't modern and kind of competing with other modern retail centers like 1431, the stuff that's happening on 1431. There's a tricky intersection there, and that creates a lot of problems. And so people that might entertain stopping know how hard it is to get in and out there and might think otherwise. We ask about we heard a lot about how there's generally a feeling that the corridor is in decline. The types of businesses, they're not generating the revenue of the types that were there before. And so we ask, what's causing that in your mind? And a lot of it's just the market's shifted to other areas. There's no real destination to attract people, you know, so you don't have one major draw that gets people there, and then you spend a few more minutes going to a couple other shops. It's been developed in kind of a hodgepodge, no cohesion, and we know how tricky and how much traffic is carried on Bell Boulevard that to have to go all the way back out to get to the next shopping center is a real challenge for people. What are the market conditions for Bell Boulevard? Basically, like I said, the market's shifted, the market's trending downwards. Specific to Bell, it's a rosy for this corner of the metro area, though. So this isn't the only area this is unique in this part of the city in that it is in decline. You see 1431 and it's a real success. We'd like to see more live-work opportunities here, perhaps. We heard some other things about what improvements do you want to see happen? Anything to promote redevelopment of the older building stock with new development. Remove old 183 was an idea, that it's the old highway right-of-way that backs up to the railroad and it's kind of wasted space, not a whole lot of cars go back there. So what can we do with that? Create a sense of vibrancy, a destination. What do you want to see left the same? People really liked the mom-and-pop types of stores that are there, hamburger joints and other businesses there. So we want to make sure that we preserve that through the area. Preserve the undeveloped open areas, but make them accessible. So people were aware of Buttercup Creek Nature Preserve, but know that they can't get to it. So what can we do to help provide some access to that? Maintain the traffic counts so that we can continue to function as a main thoroughfare through town. But also be thinking about how to improve it for business so that they can take advantage of all those cars going by improving access. We also, you'll see, we've got some goals, and part of this is whatever we come up with here as a group, we have to make sure that it really projects out there for the world what the identity of Cedar Park is. And obviously you're all here because you love Cedar Park. So we're asking, what is the identity of Cedar Park? What do you think it is? What is it we're projecting out there to the world? And what we heard is that there's no real strong identity for Cedar Park, but words like feels like home, small town and rural, which, you know, I think is interesting because I think of this as a high growth area and that there's been so much development that's happened over the years. This is where some of the most historic elements of Cedar Park were, and so there's an opportunity here to kind of convey that out to the world. Family-friendly came up many, many times, almost unanimously from the initial interviews that we had. So those are just some initial things. We're hoping to hear a lot more from you. We're already picking things up in social media about Bell Boulevard, so we'll just continue to really understand what it is that we are trying to achieve here. So another question for you, just to get a little bit of sense of who's in the crowd here. What is your connection to Bell Boulevard? Do you live nearby or live on Bell Boulevard, you know, in Bell Boulevard, the study area? Do you live in Cedar Park, but not anywhere close to Bell Boulevard? Do you work here? Are you a property owner, business owner? Do you commute through? Use civic amenities is number 7. So are there things that you come to here, and so you end up spending time in Bell Boulevard because of those things? Member of the real estate community at large, you might have development interests that you're looking at, and then other. And we have comment cards that you might have picked up on your way in, and if you need one, we can have some people at the ready. They look like this, and anytime you click another, and we don't have time to, you know, hear from every single person, please fill this out so we know what the other was about, okay? So take a second and click all that apply here. All that apply. Well, we set the questions up differently. That last one was only a one answer. Okay. Sometimes you'll see three answers. This one's check all that applies. Okay. I think I heard somebody say, I get every single number up there. All right, anybody need more time? Okay, don't be shy and raise your hand because there's a lot to read and you guys are way far back there. Okay, so good. We have representation from a wide variety of people. We pretty much nailed all the possibilities with 1 through 8. We had 2% of the people say they were an other, and we'll hopefully get to the bottom of that with a comment card. I won't spend a lot of time taking some feedback on that one, given that we've got a lot to go through today. So you may ask yourself, it seems like we've talked about Bell Boulevard a lot, and how is this going to be different? And I think the easiest way for me to explain it is a lot of the conversations about Bell Boulevard today have been about what could we do with what's going on within the right-of-way. How could we improve the road and maybe even the sidewalks and shoulders and things like that? This study, we're going to take a little broader view than that. We feel that there's going to have to be some public-private partnerships in this to encourage redevelopment out there. There are so many challenges in this section of Bell Boulevard. And so we're going to look outside the right-of-way, and we're going to say, okay, what could happen here? And, you know, what does the property owner want to do with their property? And how could we help encourage that to happen? And so we are going to be working closely with the landowners right around Bell Boulevard, not only to improve the experience from the car in the right-of-way, but also to make sure that we are seeing redevelopment happen in this area. Okay? If improvements were to take place along Bell Boulevard corridor, what are the most important issues in your mind for us to address? And you may want to check all that apply here, but you can't. We're forcing you to pick three, because we want to hear what are the most important. We know all of these are issues, but we want to hear from you, what do you think are the most important challenges along Bell Boulevard? So creating a gathering place for the community, maintaining or improving vehicular mobility, ability to move smoothly through the area, improving pedestrian accessibility, improving vehicular accessibility, so being able to get off the road with your car, improve visual aesthetics, enhance the regional connectivity, because it is a very important regional connector, energize the corridor with activities, destination, retail, and restaurants, and realize a return on investment for the land, for land and business owners and the city. So how can we make sure that everyone wins, the taxpayer and all the people that live on Bell Boulevard? So, and then there's another, of course. So you've got to pick three, okay? Anybody need more time? All right, you guys are quick study. Good for you. That's why you vote for the Seahawks, I see. So, okay, so we got a little bit of everything. Some of the lowest ones, regional connectivity. This group's not as concerned about the regional connectivity. Number 7, energizing the corridor. Destination retail, destination restaurants, etc. Okay, and then we had an other. I'll take a comment here. The 1% of you who said other, do you care to offer one up? Yes, ma'am. And we do have a mic. If you have a big voice, that's great. But otherwise, wait for the mic for just a second. Okay.
You go ahead, Maria.
Yeah. You've got a booming voice.
You've got a big voice, right? Okay. So I'm Maria Talbot, and I think that the one of the others that wasn't on the list was something that you alluded to earlier about the natural areas along the creek. Okay. Finding a way to preserve and conserve that area and make it accessible to people who perhaps a hike and bike trail, an arboretum, preserving some of the historic properties mm-hmm. along the corridor and connecting them, and then connecting it all into a regional trail system. Because there are some beautiful natural areas, and I would hate to see them
covered with concrete. I would love to be able to preserve them for wildlife habitat, for parkland, for trails, and have it all sort of connected and fit together so that between the destination retail and other things, there are some beautiful natural areas to enjoy and you can walk to all of it.
Great, thank you, great idea. Okay, well, wonderful. All right, well, we'll make sure that that stays part of the conversation as we move forward. Okay, one of the things we like to do, instead of just shooting in the dark, we like to take places that are successful destinations for retail and restaurants, because that was one that you voted on very highly. And we want to take a look at those and really dissect them and make sure we understand what's the makeup of these areas that are doing well. And so we have a sampling here of about 10 or 11 or 12 benchmarks, we call them. And these are other retail, restaurant, mixed-use shopping areas that are successful. And we're going to use them as comparisons for us as we move through this project. It's not that we're going to go out and create another Grapevine, Texas. It's not that we're going to go out and create another Domain or Preston Town Center. It's just their points of reference for us. So if we say something like, you know, you could have X amount of retail, well, we want to know if these other places have that much retail, and is that realistic if we're trying to create a destination place? So I put this list up here, but I've got a little bit more detail on a few of those. So you'll see these crop up. You'll see them on the boards back there. You'll see them at the next meeting. It's, again, just points of reference for us as we move through the project. Some of those are the Woodlands Town Center, for example, and on the larger end of things, it's you can see it's right off of Six Pines, and that carries just about the same amount of traffic as Bell Boulevard does. So I think, you know, that's an interesting one, and how they were able to accomplish retail, and you can see a picture of that environment there if you haven't been to the Woodlands yet. We also have, we'll take a look at the land uses there, about 66% commercial. You get off the major arterial here and you go into the development, and inside of it, it's got walkable blocks, shorter blocks, easy access for cars and whatnot. Another one, South Lake, Texas. Again, very similar. You start to see a little bit of a pattern about things as you start to look at it. This one has a large hotel component though. It's become a destination place where people go and spend the weekends. And so, you know, again, you get off of a major arterial, in this case, South Lake Boulevard, and you go into the development, and all of a sudden it breaks down immediately into walkable blocks and with on-street parking and other things of that nature. Other Texas examples, Addison Circle, for those of you who've been there, Arapahoe Street here is about 18,000, so a lot less than you all have. And then we have here Dallas North Tollway, about 13,000. But once you get off those main arterials, all of a sudden you've got this little walkable environment here. You can see this one's very heavy on residential with a little bit of retail at the ground floor, but that's not the real driving force of this. This is office and residential. Hill Country Galleria is one that's a little closer to home. And in this case, what I find interesting is that the major arterial does run right through the middle of it. But it's almost like this is its own little destination, and this is its own little destination over here. So you've got kind of two little centers, a lot of commercial. They've got some open space, residential, a nice mix of uses. Georgetown, Texas. Now, you might say, well, those were mainly all single developers. They owned all the land, and they did all that themselves. And I agree. It's a tough comparable here in Cedar Park because you've got multiple landowners, and they're all going to have different ideas about what they want to do with their property, and the city's going to be, you know, trying to figure out how they can help make sense of this area. So let's take a look at a couple examples that are multiple owners. So Georgetown and Grapevine are both examples of cities that have really done well maintaining their mixed-use, vibrant destination qualities. So you're very familiar with Georgetown, given that it's just around the road. And it's got a big civic component to it because it's a county seat and all of that. But it's got commercial, office, residential, a little bit of open space, all of that mixed in there. Grapevine, on the other hand, is also a mix of uses. You can see the arterials here. The one that goes through downtown is about 15,000. The major arterial next to it is about 27. So you can see that those little downtowns that are vibrant little destination places don't have 48,000 cars going right through the middle. Usually they're off the one side or the other of that. Okay? There are also, we were asked to also bring in a little bit more examples from other places. You know, what are some other really great town centers? These are great ones because they've been around a long time and they've kept their value for a really long time. It wasn't just the first sale of everything, that they've gone on and had successful, you know, couple decades of run here. So we've got Santana Row in San Jose, and this is again another great example of a development, very busy, major arterial next to it, Winchester Road there. Again, a nice mix of residential, commercial, some open space. We've got Reston Town Center, which is probably the granddaddy of all the town centers that are happened in the last, you know, 20 or 30 years. It's one of the older ones. And it's also, you see the pattern here, it's got a major arterial, you come off of it into this little walkable center. So those are some of the benchmarks we're looking at. I want to hear from you all if there's others. Or if you disagree with some of these. So we've got a question. Do you agree that we're looking at the right benchmarks? And again, it's not saying we're replicating them exactly. It's just to inform us and make sure we're not drawing pictures that are completely unrealistic and that would never happen. These are successful town centers that have some longevity to them. And what can we learn from them? So, choose one here. Okay, anybody need more time on that one? All right. Okay, we've got a lot of agreement. We've got a couple people that strongly disagree, so they probably have some ideas about town centers that we should be looking at. You want to offer up any ideas? Yes, sir.
I just want to make sure that the lady's comment is a really great comment. Those of us that have been in Cedar Park for many, many years or decades, as some of us have been, the great thing about Cedar Park is our parks and our park systems and how all of that's interconnected. I really want to make sure that as we plan this, that we make sure that we're connecting our parks and we're making and all of that aspect stays in Cedar Park. There are many, many families that use our parks, that use the trails. That really needs to be part of this. I want to make sure that it's incorporated.
Perfect.
So I want to just make sure the lady's comment, it was a great comment.
It's definitely resonating with me. Thank you, sir. How about you? Any other benchmarks that you'd like to offer up?
Yeah, well, yes. Because okay. I wanted to punch strongly agree because I like half of those, like Santana Road, one of my favorite places in the world.
Yeah. Okay.
But the problem I see is that Bell Boulevard, to me, needs to have something else happening. It's not like a big, huge development like Domain going in there. It's what you do with a corner of Boulevard and that kind of scaling. There are examples of things like that. Like a lot of these Boulevard studies are happening around the country, and I'll fill out a card with some examples of changing a street of boulevard and the kind of things would happen as you design that instead of thinking about taking the whole area, wiping it out, and turning it into sit down and roll.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay, do you have any specific ones?
Well, I'm trying to think of a way to. you know, this big idea like the Champs-Élysées, but not obviously, you know, boulevard with side streets. That people that own property can develop, you change the zoning, and it's the process is what I'm saying.
Right.
There's a difference between the process to do the woodlands versus the process to take Bell Boulevard to the next level. None of those, to me, hit that process.
Well, I mean, I would say Grapevine and some of those that are multiple owners, they've definitely got processes similar to what we would have to go through if we come up with a vision. So let's take one or two more, and then y'all can fill out a comment card. But back here, somebody had their hand up. Yes, ma'am.
I guess I just don't understand the space limitations. Those all seem kind of boxy and large, and knowing Bell Boulevard, it's a longer, more narrow corridor. So, and that also looked very mallish to me, and I just don't see Bell Boulevard looking like a mall. I think everybody kind of agreed, or maybe we voted with the mom and pop, Philly. I think someone said that was important. The culture here, not to just have another 1431 with Targets and
you know? So, I mean, it's not a big center, but like, I think like in Austin, there's some good examples of that, like Anderson Lane, where you have a lot of local mom and pop stores, but it's still really easily accessible, and I just think it has more of the corridor feel with the amount of land space that we have there.
Okay.
And again, I don't know the distance, but it just doesn't physically look like we have that much land to copy of the ones.
I think that's a great suggestion, that we look at something like Anderson Lane. One more, and then maybe we'll move on to the next one.
Yes, sir.
I don't have another comparison to add to the list. My worry is that the largest city on that list has the same amount of traffic that Cedar Park has today. Leander is shrinking, right? And everybody in Leander loves paying $6 a day to take 183A. Wrong. Bell Boulevard, to me, and I live right around the corner from where all this development is going on, Bell Boulevard is a wonderful place to go find a local restaurant. But I can't think of it as a destination. For me, it's a road to work. I work in downtown Austin. Please, whatever you do, don't reduce the lanes, contemplate increasing them, and we've got to look at a corridor for 60,000 to 70,000 cars 15 to 20 years from now.
Wow. Okay. Well, thank you for your input. Okay, I think that's a really good segue into the project goals, because we've been given these goals to work with, and they're pretty lofty, and we're going to work real hard to try to achieve all of them to the biggest extent possible. The vision is to create a gathering place and sense of identity for the city of Cedar Park. That's coming from a lot of conversations this community has had throughout the entire comprehensive planning process and others. And so that's the vision that we're shooting for, a gathering place. It may be a gathering place for the neighborhood, it may be a gathering place for the community, it may be a gathering place that's got more reach to it. We have to do a lot of talking, thinking, and analyzing to see what we could fit here. The goals are, create an economically vibrant corridor and energize the greater Cedar Park region. So make sure this area that feels, or at least the perception is that it's in a little bit of decline, that it is, feels energized, and that there's, you know, good things. The shops are all full, and they're all making money, and they're all you know, being very prosperous. That will help not only them but also the community at large, with sales tax and property tax and other things. Goal number two: generate return on investment for the city and private businesses, because I think that might be a little bit of why some of the previous plans weren't just tackled and taken down the field, to stay with the football references, is because there wasn't as much thought about how can we make this a win-win for everybody. So we're going to be thinking really hard about, if the city's going to spend a dollar to upgrade that road, then they better get at least a dollar back out of it, right, in some sort of value. And so, also the business owners. We can't just have plans and say, there's going to be redevelopment here, but it's not realistic. So we have to come to a plan that is realistic, realistically providing return on investment for the city and also private businesses. Work with the natural and historic assets. So that is a big goal in this process. We know that there's this great thing there, Buttercup Creek Nature Preserve. And there's also trails nearby and that are connected to trails. And so how can we really play up those things? We also know there's historic elements in the area. So how can we really maintain those? Community. The big one there is maintaining mobility. We hear it, we've heard it. We know we've got to maintain the level of throughput of that road, but also increase access, because otherwise everything on it will die on the vine. And so we have to continue to think about access into the surrounding developments. Gaining support from the affected stakeholders, including landowners, developers, and business owners. That's a big, you know, big charge, and you'll see if we put some thought to how big a charge that is in a minute. Solidify what the identity of Cedar Park is through the master planning process and the outcome of it. So those are the goals that we were given. They touch on a lot of different things, and certainly mobility is one of them. Natural assets is another one. I'm going to ask you all, what do you believe to be the most important goals to focus on? And we're going to let you pick three here. So if you had to pick three goals, what would they be?
Affordable housing.
It's not that we're going to ignore the other ones, it's just we need to know where our priorities are. So anybody need more time?
Yes.
Okay.
Could you read them, please? Could you read them? We can't
sure,
read them.
Create an economically vibrant corridor and energize the greater Cedar Park region is number one. Generate return on investment for the city of Cedar Park and private businesses. Work with natural and historic assets to define a more pleasant human experience. Maintain mobility and accommodate traffic levels while increasing access. Gain support from affected stakeholders, including landowners, developers, and business owners. And finally, solidify what the identity of Cedar Park is through the master planning process. Okay, anybody need more time? All right. So creating an economically vibrant corridor, kind of ranked up there, but we had others that were in the 20%, like working with the natural assets, maintaining mobility. So all the things we've heard, which is great, you know? I think there's a lot that we could do to work on those. Okay, so we're going to take each one of those and really think about, you know, what that could mean. Okay, so economically vibrant corridor. This is what's kind of standard belief in the planning world to be the most effective opportunity for shopping streets or retail destinations, whether it be neighborhood streets or whatever. The scale of these just changes. But you basically have a major arterial, and the shopping street is kind of once removed from the arterial. So it's on one side or the other, so that you can maintain the mobility through, but then you get people off who want to go to this place, and they have easy access through and around the district, okay? So that's kind of, you know, I mean, a lot of the textbooks would say that this is, you know, the way to go forward. It's also, they also talk about mix of uses and other things. We've heard the question, why is Bell Boulevard struggling, but other places in town are doing really, really well? And I think, you know, some of those things I showed you in the last slide kind of play out here. Right now, we've got critical mass is a bit of an issue. You know, here's 1431 over here, and this is the toll road. It's kind of turned, so north is this way, over on this side. But so basically, the route home is this way, and you got a large development about anywhere from 700 to 2,000 feet deep. Over here, we've got a major arterial running right through the middle of this, and we're about maybe 800 feet deep at any given place. So that it's going to be a challenge to get critical mass in that area unless we make the whole place kind of function more like a whole unit, you know. Mobility, we've got about the same number of cars. Actually, there's a little bit more cars on Bell Boulevard than there are on 1431 there, so, but it's roughly the same. But this was a greenfield development, so the cost to develop was less, because there weren't existing things that needed fixed and things that needed torn down. So there, that's why one area is kind of excelling and the other areas perceived to be in decline. economically vibrant, as you can see from those other destination places that I showed, those other centers, they have a mix of uses. And you do too. Here in Bell Boulevard, you can see that, there is a mix of uses. And we're just going to look at, is this the right mix? You know, do we have the right amount of retail? Do we have the right amount of residential? Do we have the right amount of office for the size of center that we could possibly do in this area? So, and if you look at it compared to all those other benchmarks, you know, civic, all of them had some, not all of them, most of them had some sort of a civic use in it, about 10%. The commercial was about 40%, honestly, between the retail and other kinds of commercial. Hotel was up to about 6%, and we don't have any hotel in this area, so that's an opportunity. Office was about 10%. You've got room to grow on office here, perhaps, and then the average for open space was about 6%, and residential was about 28%. We can look at all those uses and figure out, well, how can we get more office? How can we get more retail? How can we get more things? This is a graph showing the office space absorption over the last, you know, 14 years in the Austin Cedar Park submarket here, which is kind of this whole quadrant of Austin. And you can see that there were years where they spiked, here. So you had a lot of absorption, but you also had a lot of completions. And then we had some, economic troubles through here. And so there was a lot more absorption than there was completion. No one was building office for a while. And that put office back in demand, so people started building it. And you can see how the occupancy rate bounced around, all the way down to the 60s, mid-60s, up to the 90% occupancy rate. So we're high right now in terms of occupancy rates. You can also see, if you look at where office is in the region, that a lot of the office is out on the I-35 corridor. So there's lots more jobs and over there. Yeah, but this area is growing with office, so there's potential over here. And we just need to find out how to maximize that potential, if that's a use that we want to see here on Bell Boulevard. And so you can see some of the mixed-use retail and office developments that have been happening around. And what's the right one for CFO? Like, what's the right kind of office? Maybe it's Class A, maybe it's mixed use, maybe it's worker co-op. We don't know exactly. We'll be investigating that as we go. But one thing we do know is that there's been a lot of thinking about that, before I go on. Office, there's an organization named NIOP, and they recently put out a report on office industry and the sentiment. They're saying that increasingly tenants are asking for amenity-rich, mixed-use, suburban centers, not single-use centers. So that puts this as a real viable opportunity here. And it actually, locations by a margin of 83% to 17. So if you compare these kind of suburban mixed-use places, 83% to 17% for the more single-use areas. So looking at other uses, like residential uses, for example, we know that we need some based on the benchmarks. I mean, we have some today. We need to continue to have residential. So what's the right kind of residential for us? So you can see some of the developments that have happened in the area. And this is the Cedar Park subregion, by the way. We know that the rents in the Cedar Park subregion are not keeping up with the whole metropolitan statistical area. So we're getting units like this when other parts of Austin are getting units like this. Mixed use, kind of higher end units. Yes, ma'am. We'll take the question.
Could you name streets or landmarks or something like that when you're talking about these areas? When we live right off of this space, mm-hmm. and I'm having trouble visualizing what areas you're targeting.
Well, we're talking about Bell Boulevard all the way from 1431 down to the toll road. But
when you talk about the sub area, I don't have a frame of reference for what that is.
Okay, so a map. I gotcha. Okay, so the Cedar Park area is really the sub region is kind of this whole northwestern quadrant of Austin. And it reaches all the way to the lake, but down into the suburbs of, the inner suburbs of Austin. The Metropolitan Statistical Area is the entire region, so it includes all the suburbs around it, okay? All right. Retail being another use, we need to think about what's realistic in terms of retail. What could we see in terms of retail in this area? There's a couple ways we could tackle quantifying that. One is to say, we're projecting another, 3,500 roughly new households in the next 5 years, and we know each household has a spending power of about $24,000. So that could be $83 million worth of new household expenditures. How much retail would that support in this area? Not all in Bell Boulevard, possibly, but in this area. So that's one way. Another way to triangulate it would be to say, we think there's going to be this many people in 5 years, about another 8,800, and they have the regional kind of retail space per capita in the area is about 26 square feet per person. So if we factored it that way, we could have about 230,000 more square feet of retail. And not all of it in Bell Boulevard, probably. That'd be the whole entire Cedar Park area. So where would it go, and what proportion of that would we be able to see perhaps happening here on Bell Boulevard? If you look at some of the retail and its location and size, I mean, a lot of the newest retail and a lot of the largest retail is down by Lake Lyon Boulevard. And so, but there is some up and down here, and we just need to think about how we can get that new retail in this area, if that's a use we want to support this idea of a destination place. So some retail precedent imagery here, you know, just talking about what people are looking for. They're wanting it to be resilient. They're wanting this to keep its value over time. A matter of location, they need it to be visible. They need it to have lots of traffic, all the things that you have here. And so how can we create a retail environment that would be sustainable and resilient in the long term? So, how important is it to you to create an economically vibrant corridor and energize the greater Cedar Park region? Okay, anybody need more time? That was kind of the economic goal, and how important really is that to you, based on everything you saw, kind of, you know. Yes, sir.
I just had a general question, like all the information you're presenting on screen tonight, is that, if we wanted to look that over later on, is that going to be available on the city's website, or can we go to the city offices?
Yeah, at the end, I'm going to tell you how you can get all these updates, and we'll go right through that. Yes, it will be.
Thank you.
Yep. So you can let your pen down and relax and just absorb it. Okay. All right, I'm going to close the poll then. Okay, so we're leaning towards very important. Okay. Return on investment. As I mentioned, there's a couple ways of thinking about it. One is the city's investment. Anything the city puts in this costs money. Any improvements to Bell Boulevard costs money. And are they going to see an equal or greater return on that investment? And we think there's a lot of opportunity here. So if you look at these assessed values here for the area, and it looks like a big number, but if you break it down in per square foot values, you're at $8.66 a square foot, which is a lot lower than a couple of the other benchmarks like Georgetown or Round Rock, those in this immediate area. It's about 73% of the average of Cedar Park, so it's below the average. This is your oldest, the center of your community, and it's bringing in less revenue per square foot than the other parts of Cedar Park. There's a lot of room there for improvement. It's less than half of Round Rock's value downtown. But, you know, the value citywide for Round Rock and Cedar Park is about the same. So their downtown is really contributing to the value of the community in the long run. So there's also the idea of ROI for developers. And I think this gets a little touchy for some people because we're taxpayers and we don't need to make developers rich, and that's not what we're suggesting. But if we have visions, and this is an example of a place that had a vision, but this is what exists there, we've got to make sure that we have ways, we can see a path for realistically getting from here to there. And so that's really, really important. And the city's not going to be able to do it all either, right? So they're going to need the private sector to really step up and deliver that vision. Only the rights of way and some other key green spaces and things would be things that the city could actually help with. All the rest of the stuff in that picture, other people are going to need to help with. The private sector is going to need to help with. So RCF has taught us a lot about how to think about, you know, return on investment for developers. And these are this is some information that they've shared with us. So on the left, if you're visualizing that project that I just showed you, and it had a $10 million, let me go back, it had a $10 million income revenue for that site, given what was already on it, then you need to make sure that the outcome of this is at least $10 million. Otherwise, that person who has the land, there's really no incentive for them to do anything with it, right? And so one way to do it is you add up all the costs and you see, okay, it's going to cost maybe $34 million, and we think the capitalized value at the end would be about $50 million. So there's a residual land value of $16 million, which is greater than $10 million. So good, this might pencil. You know, somebody might get interested in this project. And so that's a doable project, and that's ideal, for example. Reality is oftentimes different than that. The real costs come in, and they're all just a little bit more. construction costs are higher, it's higher, you know, site costs, financing is higher, you know, blah, blah, blah. And next thing you know, you've got a feasibility gap here. And that doesn't make the project pencil. So how can the public investment that the city would make in streets and parks help to, you know, alleviate some of that feasibility gap there if the true intention is to deliver a redeveloped center at some point? So another way to look at it, and where we'll be headed, and this is just a hypothetical here, but we'll be headed at trying to explore, you know, what's the right uses, and they're not all going to happen right out of the gate. Sometimes, you know, one use might be ripe for redevelopment in this area, and so that one might be the first thing that happens in phase one. Other things might not be realistic until clear out into the long term. And so we'll be looking at every single possible use that we might entertain in this area, and we'll be saying, is this a short-term thing? Like, do we think developers might want to do this today, or is this a long-term thing? Because that's going to inform our phasing in this project, all really important to be able to make sure that we can deliver a project. So as a taxpayer, how important is it to you to generate return on investment for the city of Cedar Park and the private development, private businesses along Cedar Park? Okay. Anybody need more time on this one? All right. This is very important. Good. Okay, that's good. Because we know we're going to have lots of partners in this to make it happen. Okay, those of you who brought up natural assets, we agree wholeheartedly that there is a huge opportunity here. If you look at some of the other benchmarks of these, you know, very popular town centers, Addison Circle, for example, or Reston Town Center, all of them have some parks and open space in them, some natural asset of some sort. And, you know, this one has 13.87 acres, Addison Circle, Reston Town Center has about 5.5 acres. There is, right now, the Buttercup Creek Nature Preserve is almost 12 acres, but it's undeveloped. So if you go over here and say what percentage of this area is natural assets that are, you know, functioning as an asset for this area versus just a vacant piece of land mixing in with the other vacant piece of land, right now we're at about 0%, so there's lots of room for improvement. But others are 8 to 12% natural assets. And you can see here kind of the scale of it. This is Park Street right here. And this is Cypress Creek Road. This is Buttercup Creek Boulevard here. And so that's Buttercup Creek Nature Preserve. This is the floodplain here, which is all down through this area. You've got vacant land throughout the area. There's a lot of opportunities here to really make a great natural asset in this area. So, another question for you. I believe the most important physical challenges along Bell Boulevard are: 1, vehicular mobility; 2, driveways and grading; 3, pedestrian and bicycle mobility; 4 is parking; 5 is flooding and stormwater management; 6 is lighting; 7 is accessibility to parks and open space; 8 is burying power lines; 9 is insufficient communication infrastructure; and then other. And this is about physical challenges to Bell Boulevard. There may be other kinds of challenges, but okay. So what do you think, and you can choose 3, and again, if you change your mind, type the 3 most important in one more time. Okay. All right. Anybody need more time? Okay. Saw a couple hands.
Where's the 10 on here?
10 is 0. Yeah, sorry about that. 10 is a 0. Good question. All right. Yes, sir.
Sir, if you find something very important, can we just pick it 3 times, or does it have to be 3 different numbers?
No, this one will only accept one vote. Yeah. Yeah. Okay, so I'm going to close this poll unless someone screams now. Okay? Yes, sir.
One of the things here that I'm seeing that I'm not sure that's being brought out is we've got 2 different things that are somewhat incompatible. We've got traffic flow and we've got use. Some of these things, you know, it's very nice, and I would really like to have an extra, you know, 50% on return investment, blah, blah, blah. But if it puts another 100,000 cars through my front yard, it's not quite that good a thing. And the questions that you're asking is basically leading us to certain results. And I'm not sure that it's the best results for what we as residents really want.
Okay, good comment. I think, you know, at this point, we don't have any plans yet about what to do here, but when we do, we're gonna try to, because it's a goal to maintain mobility and increase access, we're gonna have to quantify that. And so we won't be doing anything, you know, behind closed doors about that. We'll be showing you what kind of impacts we think each concept moving forward has. And you'll be able to say, that's too much, that's not enough.
But again, the questions you're asking lead to certain results. You know, everybody wants a great dessert. Mm-hmm. Well, maybe. You got to find, when you cut the cost, it's not just dollars and cents, it's a lot of other things. Mm-hmm. And like I say, the questions you're asking here are giving you a result that may not be what we really want to express.
Okay, well, I definitely want to hear what you want to express. And I think that, I mean, we've got diverse goals, ranging from economic to natural assets to mobility to, you know, engaging the public. And so right now, we're just getting your feedback on how important are these goals for you. And so, you know, but if you have other ideas of other things that need to be goals or other things we need to consider, I'd really like to hear those from you, okay? So either fill out a comment card or stick around and we can talk afterwards, okay? All right, I'm going to close this poll. All right, so we've got vehicular mobility being kind of the most important challenge, and then a bunch of other things. Some of the lower ones, lighting, flood, stormwater management, and infrastructure or insufficient communications infrastructure are things that maybe aren't things we need to worry about too much at this point. So, all right, how important is it to you to preserve or enhance natural and historic assets to define a more pleasant human environment or experience? Okay, so this is Buttercup Creek. It's this floodplain that I mentioned to you before. Okay, anybody need more time on this? Okay. Okay, anybody need more time now? All right. Okay, important. Good, I kind of sensed that from the crowd. The next goal is maintaining mobility. A lot of you have raised that as a big concern. And this is a chart that, you know, I think is really important. It shows that as you increase mobility, sometimes your accessibility decreases. And so because we want both, we gotta find the sweet spot. Right now, major arterial here is on the high end of mobility, and that's Bell Boulevard, for example, but the accessibility is not very good. On the other hand, you've got Park Street, a local street, you know, and the accessibility is pretty good in and out of there, except for at certain times of day. And a major collector is sort of that area where you see a lot of destinations happening. So where is the major collector here? And does it exist today? Do we need to build a major collector to make sure that we have room for a destination if that's the point? The point is we don't want to screw up the mobility, but we need to provide additional accessibility to the businesses if we're hoping that they survive and that they continue to thrive and meet all those other goals we have. So just a couple existing conditions around that. I think we've mentioned before that we're somewhere in the neighborhood of about 40 to 45,000 cars a day on Bell Boulevard. So this is the section between Buttercup Creek Boulevard and Park Street. We've got about 22,000 cars that go south every day, and we've got about 19,000 cars that go north. So somebody's taking it home. Awesome. Is it that or they're getting lost or something? I don't know. But, But anyway, that gives you a sense of the vehicular loads, and we've been tasked, our goal is to maintain that. So we got to figure out how to keep that, how to plan for future, and also to get more accessibility in and out of each of the sites, but also the intersections. Right now we've got a few intersections. The Cypress Creek Road here goes down to, I don't know if you know, but like intersections are graded according to level of service, and it's based on how many seconds you sit at an intersection. And so an F means you're sitting there for greater than 80 seconds. You're probably multiple lights. And there are times when Cypress Creek Road in the morning, as you're coming out and trying to get onto Bell Boulevard or pass through Bell Boulevard, that it's an F. You're sitting there for longer than 80 seconds. So, but the other intersections are not too bad. We're down in the B, C's, and D's, which, you know, D's are creeping up into danger zone and kind of uncomfortable there. But you know, this is important. This is part of accessibility. How can we straighten out these intersections and make sure they flow? How can we also add better access to the parcels in between? Yes, sir.
It seems to me the obvious fix for the commute traffic is to get rid of the toll on the toll road. All the toll roads. No, seriously. And you'll say, oh, well, we can't do that. The city government could do something, lobbying the legislature or whatever, to get rid of the toll on the toll roads. All the toll roads are a horribly inefficient land use because obviously people don't want to pay the toll. So there's this beautiful road and nobody's driving on it. That would, if you could take the pure commute cars off of Bell and put them on the toll road where TxDOT really wants you to drive, so they make you go through all this.
For those of you in the back, I think because it might be having a hard time hearing, he's saying one of the key things we could do to solve all the problems would be to remove the toll from the toll road.
And I think the city government could take a lead.
This is the time to bring out big ideas. And so, you know, let's talk about big ideas. And I think that that you know, we'll be talking about big ideas as we move through this process, and we should keep that in the mix. All right. How important is it to you to maintain mobility and accommodate traffic levels while increasing access? We've got a couple more goals to go. All right. Okay. Anybody need more time on that one? Okay, I'm going to close it unless somebody screams. Yes, sir?
I wish the question had been rephrased. Okay. How important is it to maintain mobility and accommodate traffic levels regardless of whether you increase the access?
Okay. Yeah, I guess, you know, here we're saying to make a vibrant urban center, we're going to have to increase access to this, to the properties next door, to Bell Boulevard. And so how important is that to you? Okay? All right, I'm going to close this. You ready? Okay, we got a few people say not important. I'm guessing that might be related to your concern, sir. So noted, and we will definitely be thinking about that as we move forward. Okay, so we had a goal of gaining support from affected stakeholders, and you all represent that group. You represent a very diverse group. We had somebody in every single one of those categories early on. These are just some targets, perhaps. So informing on the left side, there's going to be just a whole bunch of people in Cedar Park that just want to know that something's going on and that it's good. They've got a concern about Bell Boulevard, but they don't really have either the time or the interest in participating, and we want them to be aware of it. So we've got media here tonight, thank you, and we'll continue on with that and with social media and websites and all those people who just want to know what's going on, but they don't have any plans in participating. We hope to reach at least 85% of those people. The people that want to participate, we want to provide avenues for them. And so the interested public, so the people that actually come out and talk and that come to our meetings and say things like yourself, but also get on social media and say things, take surveys as we move through this process, we hope to hit 5%. You know, so that's public comments, surveys, and social media. And inside the study area, there's 750 people, so it could be 5% of that. But, you know, this is an important place for all of Cedar Park, so we're shooting big. You know, we're hoping to involve a lot of the community in this conversation, and you'll all be part of that. Key stakeholders, we've already met with a number of the landowners. We've sent letters to everybody. We're trying to get the people that have a real interest in Cedar, in Bell Boulevard at the table so that we know that whatever comes out of this is realistic and that it's got the buy-in of the stakeholders. Collaborators, these are folks like city council work groups, Cedar Council work group sessions and stakeholder interviews. These are people that might have a role in implementation. So, you know, it might even be TxDOT and other folks that have a real role in this. And then the deciders, the decision makers here, we need to keep them up to date. I'm so glad to see all the city council members here, 4B board members, and the zoning commission. I think that's really, really important. So it's going to be tough, and we've got a big goal ahead of us, and we're going to work real hard. So how important is it to you that we gain the support of all the affected stakeholders? Okay? All right. Anybody need more time? Okay. All right. Very important. Okay. So the last goal, I think, is the toughest one, maybe. It's about the identity of Cedar Park and making sure whatever we do reflects the identity of Cedar Park. The challenge is that the identity of Cedar Park is different. For everybody's perception of the identity is probably different. And so we ask ourselves, what does this place look like? That's one way of saying what the identity is. So what does this place look like? How is it being perceived physically? Just get somebody who drives down here, what are they thinking? The next place is, what goes on in this place? I mean, a lot of... You think of Austin, and part of the character of Austin is all the events that happen there. People all over the world know about Austin because of the events that happen there. And then how do other people see this place is also a way of kind of gauging the identity of Cedar Park. Because if you're projecting out an identity, it's really about how other people are perceiving it. So a couple things, I mean, what does this place look like? We could look at things like the building types, and their condition and whatnot. So we've got a map here that talks about the different building types. Are they commercial? Are they governmental buildings? Are they historic? So that's important and contributes to the physical environment out there. But also the age of buildings is important. And have we seen a lot of new development in this area? We really haven't seen a whole lot of. We've seen some renovations and some upgrades to facilities, and so that's important. Quick question for you. How would you rate the overall appearance of buildings along Bell Boulevard today? Okay, anybody need more time? I have a feeling you probably thought long and hard about this one for a long time. So, anybody need more time? Okay. Okay, we've got buildings that are underperforming in the eyes of the people of Cedar Park. We also, as I mentioned, could talk about events. When you look at some of these other benchmarks out there, like Grapevine, Georgetown, and the number of outdoor events that they have in their little downtown areas, they've got a lot going on. And right now, in this area, Cedar Park doesn't have any events. So that's an area we could build from. We could build from here. I mentioned the other way of looking at it is, how are you perceived in this region? So think of a realtor, for example, who gets a call from somebody from, you know, California or New York or something, and they're moving to Austin, Texas, and they need to find a place to live. What does that realtor say about Cedar Park? And why do they send them here instead of Round Rock or other communities around the region? And so one tool is there's a program called Esri, and they do a tapestry segmentation. This is software for market people to really think about what's the market for things, real estate specifically. And so you can see on the, these are words they came up with, not me. But along the I-35 corridor, you see a lot of things like bright young professionals, up-and-coming families, American dreamers, you know, lots of tech people on the I-35 corridor. On over here at Cedar Park, you see a lot more like family-oriented things. And to drill into that a little bit more, you see these are the three profiles that come up for Cedar Park. You've got soccer moms, families, very active. They love their recreation, and I'm guessing that's why they settled in Cedar Park. Up-and-coming families, residents that are young and more mobile and diverse. They like their leisure activities. They like events. They like to feel active and like they're doing something. Boomers is another one, and again, these are all terms they came up with, not me. These are families that have traded up once. They're not starter families. This is probably their second home. And so they're here in Cedar Park, and this is probably their long-term home. This is where they've decided to settle to have their kids and raise their family. So that's how other people are perceiving, which I think is great. A lot of this is matches directly with what we were hearing in some of those initial interviews about home. This place is home. This is small town. This is, because again, when you look at it, it doesn't feel like small town, knowing how much growth this has happened. But the perception in the people's heart is that this is a small town, and it's a very tight-knit community. So I'm going to ask you a couple of polar opposite questions here, just to kind of flesh out sort of what is the identity of Cedar Park. So, and you can always answer free, which in this case is neutral or neither, okay? But is the current identity of Bell Boulevard more modern, or is it more traditional? There's a little bit of everything going on out there. What do you think? Okay? Anybody need more time? And I'm going to ask you a series of these, so don't think these are the only two. Okay, I'm going to close this unless somebody screams. All right. Okay, we're trending towards traditional. Good to know. So, if we change those words to eclectic or consistent, so eclectic, kind of random and a little, you know, think of Burnett or other areas where it's very eclectic but can be lots of fun, or is it consistent but also very fun? So, which one would you say? All right, anybody need more time? Lots of people in on these, I always get that. All right, we're all over the place here. We got eclectic, we got consistent, so that's good. All right, are we active or are we passive? Are we, is this a place known for activity and things going on, or is this an area where you come and you rest and you relax? These are tough ones, but if we ask enough of them, then we'll eventually get to some sort of description. So, okay, anybody need more time? All right. Neither. Okay, we're all in court on this one, too. Okay, timeless or trendy?
Neither.
All right. Lots of people here. Any more time, though? Okay, I'm going to close the poll then. Small town or big town? You know, your numbers are creeping up towards big town. But is your perception, your identity, small town or big town? Yeah, I'm sorry. That became bullets, but it's 1 through 5. All right. Anybody need more time? I'm going to guess what this one is. I knew it. All right. Good. Well, those are things, we're not done asking you those questions, and they might seem ridiculous, but we need to know kind of where y'all think, what is the identity of Cedar Park? Because we're going to try to nail it on this one. So, all right, so we think that we've got to distill all of this into some opportunities and challenges, and there's a number of both. We can enhance and take advantage of those opportunities that we have out there, like Buttercup Creek Nature Area is a great opportunity. And right now, it's underappreciated, and I think there's a lot of room there. Significant vacant land. I mean, that's a good opportunity for us. There's not things already built that you know, are taking up space and maybe not fitting a vision. So let's get an opportunity to see what would be good on those vacant parcels. High commuter volumes. You can see that's on both the opportunities and the challenge list, because I think we've all discovered that's a tough one, right, for access. But we've got to have it to get the mobility and visibility to the area. On the challenges side, we've got obstructed views, we've got grade separations, we've got existing infrastructure that we have to work around, overhead power lines and storm ditches and all kinds of things. And so what can we do with those? And a high volume of commuters, which can be a big challenge, but also very necessary for the things we have here. So I'm going to wrap up in just a second, but I always like to ask this question at the end of the meetings, and we'll take some questions after this. But I like to ask, do you think that given that we're at kind of the very entry point of this project, that today we're heading in the right direction by thinking hard about the existing conditions on the ground there? Or do we need to step back, regroup, and try a whole different deal? So you may not have agreed with everything that came up today, but do you think that this process is on the right path, you know, with stakeholders, with analysis, et cetera? Okay, anybody need more time on that one?
Yes,
okay. You always talk about bringing music to play, you know, to tunes. All right, anybody need more time? Okay, I'm gonna close that then. So we're heading in a right direction. We got a couple people with some reservations. I want to hear from you, you know? I mean, I send my mom and dad this and they have my refrigerator after every meeting. So, yes, sir.
Paul Fuller, I've lived here a long time, business owner as well. What do you plan on doing with the businesses in this corridor that don't fit in the profile of, you know, this plan? Because being that it's a hodgepodge of businesses all up and down, going to kick them out, relocate them, encourage them to move? Do y'all have ideas?
Yeah, we don't have ideas yet. Do you? I mean, do you have any ideas yet about what we do with businesses there? That
I can give you some.
Can you write it, please?
I mean, I think some relocating, but I mean, either buying them out, finding another location in Cedar Park, things like that would probably work well, but talking to most of them and seeing, because a lot of them are mom-pa places, but they're not the mom-pa places that I think we're going for in this area. But I've lived here a long time, and I've personally seen businesses start up and fail due to aesthetic reasons. You can't get into the parking lot. Mm-hmm. You just pass it. I mean, like Popeye's Chicken and the Mexican food place there have been there a long time because they got good service and good food, but any new businesses don't last because you can't get into the parking lot.
Right.
And so I think accessibility is huge on this. Mm-hmm. Getting in and out of places easily where you're not going to get hit trying to pull out. Mm-hmm. So just things to think of.
Yeah, very good. Good points. A challenge we need to solve is, you know, how to, a phasing in general of anything, you know, whatever the vision ends up being, how do we get it phased in a way that makes sense, that, you know, provides ROI incrementally to everyone involved, and also doesn't disrupt who's left there and not considered part of phase one. Yes?
If I may, I think the overwhelming theme here is traffic. You know, it seems like the ideas that you presented in the initial scheme comparing different, you know, arteries and how they develop, all of our traffic is already exceeding those. And so we've got a major highway that is not being used. And I think until we address the fact that we're not utilizing what's already there, we're not going to be able to develop Belt Boulevard into, you know, if we widen the highway or continue with the traffic plan it is, nobody's still going to stop there. Mm-hmm. It's not going to have a mom and pop theme to it. It's going to be just drive right by on your way to work. So if I were to emphasize anything, it would be ideally steering everybody towards 183A, and that's step one. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, I think, you know, any major move with mobility is going to be a long way out. It's not a 5-year thing. It's a 20-year thing. And so I think we don't want Bell Boulevard to sit there, you know, and continue to decline for 20 years. So regardless of what might happen in the future with, you know, 183, the tollway or a frontage road or anything else that we've heard come up in previous conversations, we still need a plan for the short to medium term. You know, what are we going to do to stop the decline today and reverse it? So we got a couple of questions over here.
I'm Mike McCloskey. I'm a former chair of the Planning and Zoning Commission back in the mid-2000s. And one of the things that happened, and I think one of the reasons why we're here today and why this conversation has been going on for a long time is the lack of consistency. And I think that's something we really need to look at. I think that's a lot of the reason why this discussion has been going on for a long time. When 183A came through, and I was involved in Planning and Zoning at that time, I said, you know, we had a second chance to make a first impression. when that road came through, and we saw what happened with the 1431 development that's taking place. There's a lot more consistency that's happening there. And I think that's what we need to have as a long-term goal. I mean, it's not going to happen overnight. You know, we have a lot of owner interest with a lot of different divergent things that they're looking for out of this. But I think ultimately we need, and I think that may include certain planning and zoning processes that we look at, how we look at consistency in construction, how we look at setbacks, how we look at all those kind of things, that we do that. I noticed one of the pictures that came out when this was being promoted was a more city center looking with a sidewalk up against it, with storefronts up against it. Of course, that doesn't look anything like Belle Boulevard now. So, I mean, we'd have to look at how we change that and how we get everybody to buy into it. But I really think we need to have a goal of consistency in our construction and all the things that we do if we're going to make this work.
Mm-hmm. Great points. Yeah. We've got a couple more on this side, so let's take a few more. I want to get everybody out of here. We're up in time, but we'll stick around and take questions afterwards. Yes, ma'am.
I just had a quick comment about, kind of related to the direction of this. Mm-hmm. It's not exactly a comment, but a concern.
Mm-hmm.
At the beginning, with the pictures that we were given right at the start of the presentation that looked more like the Domain and things like that, that are very, very highly developed, highly regular. Mm-hmm. And I think that clashes with what came later in all of the presentation in terms of using green spaces, keeping the mom and pop feel, the traditional nature, the rural aspect of this. So where it's headed in the right direction, I do agree, but I feel like that this came up in some of the comments too, that what direction is it? Are we looking for, economic viability means bringing in something that looks like the Domain, which were mm-hmm. most of the pictures we saw at the beginning, mm-hmm. or really keep the feel to some extent of that rural traditional mm-hmm. idea, but bringing it way up to date and adding in things. And I felt like I was pulled both ways because I wasn't sure what my answer was actually answering in terms of, I want it economically viable, but I don't want that to mean we're going to line it with a ton of stores that are four stories high all the way up and down.
Right. Okay. Very good input. And I think, I'm kind of glad to hear that we kind of hit both, throughout the presentation in a way, because at this point, we don't know where we're headed yet with this. We don't know what could be achieved in this area physically, from a market standpoint, any of that yet. But so we'll be presenting some concepts at the next meeting, and maybe we do some that reflect kind of a different grain, something that's a little bit more consistent, but then something that's also a little bit more, I don't know what the word would be, but not eclectic, but eclectic maybe, but in a good way. So, yes, ma'am.
Hi, my name is Vivian, and I live right off of Park Street, and I commute into Austin. So I'm looking at this both as a resident and a commuter.
Mm-hmm.
And one of the things I think, and I appreciate all the work and all the presentation, all the research that has gone into this, but one of the things I feel like I'm missing is kind of a holistic view of where Belle Boulevard fits within Cedar Park's plan in general. Mm-hmm. I think having it be a thoroughfare is one thing, and if we knew that there was this community-centered, mm-hmm. Really pretty, some of the complexes that y'all showed earlier, somewhere else close in Cedar Park, you could have a complementary system
mm-hmm.
of having the thoroughfare not try to be two different things.
Mm-hmm.
And the other thing, as far as working with what's around us, it is so close to Austin. We have control, in my understanding, up to the Austin boundary, but when Austin traffic backs up, even up to Cypress Creek and things like that, when there's a wreck on 183 and people are trying to access it, I mean, it can get pretty hairy. So if we're trying to enable commuters to go into downtown Austin to work and then create some of these businesses and multi-purpose areas, it feels like we're working at cross-purposes. So not having that holistic vision it's confusing to me.
Right. Well, we have a long way to go. We got to see if we can achieve all these goals and to what level we can achieve every goal. So let's do one more. I know we're running a little late, and then we'll close up, and then everybody can come and pounce on us later. So yes, ma'am, let's take one more. She's had her hand up for a while. So.
Well, when it comes to retail, the good news is we've had a lot of different types of retail come to Cedar Park in the last couple of years, and
8 years ago, I couldn't buy sporting goods or go to the movies in Cedar Park or go to a sit-down place to have dinner. I mean, so many more retail opportunities have come to Cedar Park. And yet there's one category that we still don't have, but I still have to go to the Domain, Burnett Road, you know, other places to buy an arboretum, and that's apparel. We need apparel. We need a place where we can go shopping for clothes and shoes more than what we've currently got. That's something that's missing. And I don't know if it belongs on Bell Boulevard, but in terms of dense mixed use, we really need apparel vendors, because that's the one thing that I still leave town to buy. Then the other thing is, you know, burying power lines. When I served on the 4B board, we did a study at the request of a previous council as to what it would cost. We came up with a price tag of $30 million. Well, I wouldn't spend one dime of the taxpayers' money if it was going to cost $30 million. If I had $30 million to spend in this town, I wouldn't be burying power lines on 183. I'd be acquiring parkland, trail right-of-way, connecting our trails, connecting our parks. I'd be maybe building a business incubator or banking land and using it for economic development. I wouldn't be using it to bury power lines.
All really good points. And I mean, I think that just goes to the fact that we don't want y'all to have to make any decisions that we can't project out there a return on investment of some sort, you know, regardless of what it is. We want to make sure that we... that we're making money off of that stuff so that you can go do more wonderful things. So, okay, just before, and like I said, I'll stick around. We'll answer any questions you have. But before we start losing people, we really hope that you will visit the website. There's opportunities on there to leave comments. There's also contact information. Do you want to do any of this?
Real quickly, thank you. A couple ways how you can stay connected on this project. One, in the back, there are two computers set up that you can sign up for e-alerts on this project. I promise I'm not going to spam you, but it's letting you know when the next workshop is, which should be sometime in April. It's letting you know about major developments in the project. We've already gotten quite a few people to sign up. Please don't hesitate. Two computers in the back. Next, if you don't follow us on social media, and you are on social media, please do. That's how we're getting a lot of the word out on this, so I would invite you to do that. Also, if you are interested in getting a copy of this presentation or emailing me with comments, all of that is available on this website. I haven't loaded the presentation yet, but I will by the end of the week. Additionally, we will have a video of this. Thank you again. Also, I've kept hearing a lot about transportation and other issues, and we share those concerns. There is a transportation master plan that is almost going for the final vote for council next month, and so we are fully aware of those issues, but we welcome this feedback and comments. It helps us know your priorities. So with that, Rebecca and I will be around. Thank you again for coming tonight.